There are moments in our childhood that spark our curiosity. And for me, it was a balloon release at my primary school. I went to a small school in a seaside town in the southwest of the UK, and they decided to have a charity balloon release that was even advertised in our local newspaper. There were 60 colourful balloons, each with the address of the school attached on the string, and it was a race to see how far they could fly. I remember standing in the playground and I heard the countdown. 3, 2, 1. We watched all of the balloons float off into the sky. But little did I know that this childhood memory would be a defining moment in my future. Out of the 60 balloons, only 5 got found. And 1 even crossed the English Channel over to France. I remember asking my mum, what happened to the other 55 balloons? And if one was crossing the English Channel, what were happening to the balloons dropping into the ocean? No one I asked knew where the missing balloons were or the impacts that they were causing. However, this curiosity led me on a path to becoming a researcher, where now I investigate the sources and fate of plastic going into our environment, and most importantly, how to stop it. And because of this, I've been best described as a plastic detective. Now, plastic is an incredibly useful, versatile, affordable material that's really revolutionized so many different products and industries. Just take a look around the room that we're in, and you'll see that the majority of items are made out of plastic. However, this convenience has come at a cost. Due to single-use plastic and our throwaway culture, we make over 400 million tons of plastic every year, and 3% of that is expected to go into our oceans. And this is expected to double by 2050 unless we intervene, making our oceans into a big plastic soup. Now, when you hear the term plastic pollution, I bet that your minds take you to a beach or a coastal scene, and bottles and bags and fragments in the water and the sand. But as plastic detectives, we wanted to investigate the weird and unique sources of plastic pollution. Our first detective case was looking at microbeads in facial scrubs. Now, microbeads were put into facial scrubs to act as exfoliants to make our skin very smooth. Take a look. Did you ever used to use any of these products? Well, when I was younger, I used to use these products, and I never considered that they might have plastic in them. But I do remember that they felt gritty to touch. We wash our face, they go down the drain, potentially through our sewage treatment works and into our ocean. But no one had done any work before looking at how many could be in one bottle, so we decided to investigate. To tackle this issue, we brought popular facial scrubs that you can get in the shop, known to contain microplastics. After hours and hours extracting them in the lab, we looked at how many microbeads were in each bottle and looked at their characteristics. We found that 3 million could be in one bottle, thousands on a squirt on your hand. But this showed me how research can be a really powerful voice and a driver to make change. We gave this evidence to consumers, like you and me, who started to boycott the products. By looking on the back of the ingredients list and seeing if it contained plastics, people weren't buying the products anymore and getting a natural alternative instead that was the same price or cheaper. Then industry started to listen, because they could see how unpopular it was becoming for the consumers, and they started to voluntarily remove the microbeads from the facial scrubs. Then the cherry on top was that our research influenced legislation worldwide banning microbeads in facial scrubs. We went back 2 years later, and we tested the same products, and all of them were microbead-free. Just like detectives, research supplies evidence. And that evidence can be used by anyone to make more environmentally conscious decisions. Next on our detective journey, we looked at washing our clothes, because the majority of the clothes that we wear are made out of plastic. Take a look at the labels of your clothes when you go home and see what your clothes are made out of. It could be polyester, acrylic, or a natural synthetic blend, about 60% of our wardrobe. And when our clothes are swishing and swirling around in the washing machine, tiny fibers can come off, and like the microbeads, go down the drain, potentially through the sewage treatment works, and then into our oceans. Our research found that 700,000 fibers could come off our clothes per clothes wash. Now multiply that by how many times you wash your clothes per week, per month, per year, and then multiply that again for a street, a town, a city. This is a huge amount of microfibers potentially making their way into the environment. What was really interesting was that there was a huge difference in the different polymer types, with a natural synthetic blend releasing hundreds of thousands of fibers less than the pure plastic counterparts like polyester acrylic. Then we further wanted to look into solutions. We tested different inventions that could be incorporated into the washing cycle to try and capture or stop the fibers. We found that they could be up to 70% effective. And this research has actually influenced legislation in France, where by 2025, all new washing machines will have to come with a filter. So watch this space, as it could be the future of washing our clothes. Now, what about other solutions like biodegradable plastics? Do they disappear in the natural environment in a quick time frame? Well, to test this, we buried biodegradable plastic bags in the soil and we submerged them in the sea to see what happened. However, after 3 years, these biodegradable bags were still there and they could still hold a full bag of shopping. Biodegradable plastics often need really specific conditions to break down, like high moisture and heat that you're only going to get in an industrial composter, not in the natural environment. So this research really showed us that even environmental solutions need to be tested to avoid greenwashing and to understand fully how they work. With our detective hats still on, we then left the lab and we went into the field to understand where is all of this plastic going. We were able to predict that a major river system could emit 3 billion microplastics every day. That's 35,000 every second. But it was more complicated than that, with a huge proportion of the microfibers and microplastics sinking down into the sediment, increasing from source to sea. But even in the air around us, we found plastics, with 100 microplastics per meter square falling on the ground in a city every day. That's about 100 microplastics in this big red circle. How about the tallest point on Earth? Mount Everest. Would we find microplastics and plastic bits up there? Well, a National Geographic expedition team went to Mount Everest and asked if we would like some snow samples, all the way from base camp to towards the summit. And I truly didn't think that we were going to find any plastic. To me, Mount Everest is pure and pristine and remote. However, in every single snow sample, we found plastic, microfibers, likely coming from the climbers' clothing and their ropes. It was almost like they were unknowingly leaving a trail of microplastics behind them. With 60 microplastics per liter of snow at base camp, where climbers are spending a lot of time, and then even 10 microplastics per liter of snow towards the summit. Is there anywhere in the world now that's untouched by plastics? It can seem like a really overwhelming and complicated web to navigate. But it's crucial to remember it's going to be very difficult to unravel that web all at once. Like a detective, we need to take it step by step, bit by bit. We need to ask questions, gather evidence, and find solutions to specific problems. And it can start with questioning a balloon release when you're younger. Moments in our childhood may shape our perspective, but it's our actions today that define our future. Merci.